Welcome to Boise Art Museum's first virtual Parlor Nights program. Thank you so much for joining us. I'm Melanie Fales, the Executive Director of the Boise Art Museum. We're doing something completely different with this program, and I hope you enjoy it. We wanted to talk with scholars and presenters who could help create an interdisciplinary humanities context for viewing and discussing the American Impressionist masterworks on display at BAM. As you know, discussions about interrelated topics were commonplace in the salons and parlors in homes of the 19th century. Our initial plan was to hold the program within the exhibition so that we could create a salon-style experience for you to feel as if you had been transported back in time to the Gilded Age. Of course, the pandemic made it impossible for us to hold the program in person, so we decided to proceed to the best of our abilities with a virtual format, and this is our foray into that platform. The discussions for this program focus on literature, domestic violence laws, women's suffrage, and the roles of women, as well as a conversation centered on music and female composers, often overshadowed by their more famous male counterparts during this era, from 1865 to 1920. At the end of the program, I'd like to ask you to please help us by completing the program evaluation so that we can provide the required information to our funders to qualify for additional grants in the future. I'm grateful to our scholars and presenters for sharing their knowledge and expertise with you, Dr. Marlene Tromp, Dr. Catherine Aiken, as well as Dr. Brian Hodges and Lindsay Bull from Classical Revolution Boise. The program will last just over 1 hour and will begin with art history, followed by interdisciplinary connections with literature, women's history, and music. Enjoy. The time between 1865 and 1920, when these artworks were painted, was a period of rapid growth, new inventions and modes of transportation, as well as increased technology and rapid change in the United States. Known as the Gilded Age, this era, at the end of the Civil War, marked the beginning of new American prosperity. Impressionism originated in France as the first modern art movement that emerged outside of the academic tradition focused on photorealistic paintings of historical, biblical, and still life subject matter. Many American artists traveled to Europe to study, see contemporary exhibitions, and try new techniques. As a result, American Impressionism was developed by leading artists including Childe Hassam, Frederick Carl Frieseke, and Mary Cassatt. Mary Cassatt was the only American artist to exhibit with the French Impressionists in Paris. In fact, Spanish dancer wearing a lace mantilla was exhibited under the title of Ida at the 1874 Paris Salon. Cassatt was a key figure in the turn of the century art world and now is considered one of the most important American expatriate artists of the 19th century. Frederick Carl Frieseke was an active part of the American Impressionist art colony in Giverny, France, where Claude Monet lived and painted. Childe Hassam was one of the original artists in the Ten, a group of painters who formed American Impressionism into a movement in its own right and opposed the more traditional society of American artists. French Impressionism aimed to capture a fleeting moment or a representation of the artist's perception of a place rather than depicting an accurate study. Artists focused on everyday places, including cities, gardens, and theaters. Adopting the bright color compositions and loose brushstrokes of French Impressionism, American Impressionists were also interested in scenes of everyday life and capturing fleeting impressions. They also wanted to lend an American sensibility to Impressionism that demonstrated patriotism and contributed to the national identity. Their harmonious, tranquil imagery of high society became an antidote to the realities of an increasingly industrial and urban life. The American Impressionists also fulfilled the societal need to idealize women's domestic roles at a time when women were taking an interest in social and civic equality, including women's suffrage. Often the use of reflection by painting mirrors, water, glass, and other shiny surfaces was a symbolic convention they used to convey that the artwork reflected life the way people wanted to see it, rather than the way it was. While Impressionism was originally rejected by the general public and collectors alike as being shocking, it has become one of the most loved styles in art history. The artworks can help us draw parallels to the human condition today and shed light on 2020 in timely ways. More than 100 years later, the artwork provides us with the opportunity to reflect upon the progress made and the challenges faced during this time through the lens of the artists, and to consider how far we have come as a result. I'm honored to introduce Dr. Marlene Trump. Dr. Marlene Trump is the 7th president of Boise State University. She's committed to supporting students and faculty, serving and advancing the state of Idaho, and helping the university foster research excellence to increase discovery for its students and the world. Before joining Boise State in July 2019, Dr. Trump was the campus provost and executive vice chancellor at the University of California at Santa Cruz, ranked by U.S. News and World Report as the 26th best public university in the country. Before joining the University of California system, broadly recognized as the premier public university system in the country, Dr. Trump was the dean of Arizona State University's new Interdisciplinary College of Arts and Sciences and the vice provost of the university's West Campus. She grew up in Green River, Wyoming, a Trona mining town along Interstate 80 that saw its population jump threefold in the 1970s when nearby mines led an economic boom. Her father worked at one of the mines. Neither of her parents were college graduates, but they supported their two daughters' college aspirations, especially when Trump decided she was going to become a doctor. She earned scholarships to Creighton University, nearly 800 miles away in Omaha, Nebraska, but the financial challenges remained tangible. Though bound for medical school, she fell in love with Robert Browning's poetry. Instead, she would go on to earn her bachelor's degree in English, come home to Wyoming to complete a master's degree, and then study for her doctorate at the University of Florida. There she wrote a dissertation on Victorian novels and the new laws being written then on domestic violence. Thank you so much for joining me today, Dr. Trump. I am so pleased to have the opportunity to have a conversation with you about your scholarly expertise and the exhibition at the Boise Art Museum. Can you begin by telling us, was there an Impressionism movement in literature as there was in visual art during the 19th and early 20th centuries? What were some of the similarities between literature and visual art during this time? And if so, how did American authors reflect this movement in their work?
I think that's such a wonderful question, and thank you so much for asking. Literature and visual art have often paralleled one another. So if we look over the long history of literature and visual art, we often see as movements occur in one, they're impacted in another. And my specialty is British literature, but of course, when one studies the 19th century, especially in an age of really intense globalization and empire, you also learn about things that are happening in other parts of the globe. And so with literary impressionism, just as in the visual world, there's a kind of disruption of clarity and authority and a focus on affect, and a sense that there's ambiguity or uncertainty. And we often associate it with folks like in the US, like Jack London, in the UK, like Rudyard Kipling or Edgar Rice Burroughs, but also folks like Virginia Woolf and Joseph Conrad. And I think about people who have imagined that there might be ways in which what we evoke is just as important as what we say.
If you were to select an example of American literature from this era that could correspond with one of the three masterworks on display, what would it be and why?
That's such an interesting question. And I think what I would lean into is, and this is a British work, but it draws on my specialty more, is Mrs. Dalloway. And I would actually say that there's a way in which it speaks to all three of these pieces. And it does so by really asking about what a woman's place is, what her body means, what her affective life means, how she relates to others in that space, and how that perception of her shapes what's possible for her, which in many ways is what Mrs. Dalloway asks about. And so what it was such a delight for me to look at these works and to think about literature in relation to them. And I also think about Chopin, Kate Chopin, and the way in which she challenged people to imagine the discomforts and disruptions in women's lives in a way that was so different from authors before her, and to think about how those disruptions actually had an enormous impact in the world around, and that often they were very minute. The disruptions might be very minute materially, but very profound emotionally. And so I think what we see in all three of these works, and what we see in the works of these two women writers, is a challenge to think differently about how you position yourself in relation to women and to their relations to others.
Interesting. Were female writers published widely during the Victorian era, roughly that period of 1865 to 1920? And can you give us some examples of famous female writers and perhaps some lesser known female writers worthy of note?
Yes, I'd love to. So absolutely, women writers were very important. But in fact, some of them took on pen names that even if people knew publicly that someone was a woman author, like George Eliot, for example, whose name was Marianne Evans, her pen name was George Eliot, wrote some of the greatest novels of the 19th century, but wrote under a male pen name because of the disruption. But I've also named a couple of others already, Virginia Woolf and Kate Chopin. Another person people might look to that they might not know is Charlotte Perkins Gilman, who wrote some incredibly profound, especially short fiction pieces, like The Yellow Wallpaper. And if people want to think about what I was describing about affect and small material events that have huge social and emotional impact, Charlotte Perkins Gilman's The Yellow Wallpaper might be of real interest. We also have poets like Emily Dickinson writing at this time. There are some brilliant African-American women writers like Frances Watkins Harper and Harriet Ann Jacobs, who were writing in part in response to this sort of emerging voice for African-Americans at a time when their rights were beginning to be carved out and articulated in the wake of great violence in the country. And so I think there are some really fascinating people out there. And I'll mention one from Britain that folks might not know. But if you're looking for a novel to read at this time, when things have been so challenging and difficult and tumultuous, and you want a little kind of a Netflix style kind of thing that you can just devour and it's easy, it's like candy. There's a novelist named Ellen Wood who wrote a series of novels, but I think the one that is the most interesting to read is East Lynne. And it's about financial complexities, interrelationships between people, and people will probably, it's a long novel, and people would probably find the first 50 pages a little dull. But trust me, if you get past those first 50, it's a little bit like looking at these beautiful moving images. You can glance at them, but if you sit and savor them, you'll find they have this incredible depth. And even though the story sort of trips lightly across the surface of things that are happening, it has a real punch.
I'll have to look for that one, definitely. Were female heroines prominent in the literature written during this time? In what kinds of plots, settings, and conflicts did female characters usually find themselves? And do you see any parallels with the portrayal of women in these three masterworks at the Boise Art Museum?
Yes, absolutely. So one of the things that was really, really pressing for both male and female writers in this period is what was called at the time the woman question. And what the woman question was it was really this, in that very profound and simple way, What is a woman's role? What can a woman do? How can a woman live in this world? So it touched all sorts of social questions. It was as women began to enter the workplace. It was a question about woman's role in the family. And what a lot of people don't know is that early in the 19th century, it was actually men who were considered the natural parent of children. So we think of this as being completely obvious. Well, of course, a woman is a natural parent. She gets pregnant, she gives birth, she nurses the child. But in the early 19th century, a lot of people thought, well, of course, the man is the natural parent because you have to have somebody with intellectual force who knows what's right for children. And women were perceived as having a kind of moral goodness, but not necessarily being able to provide that intellectual force. So if a couple separated, which of course was much more rare, if a couple separated or divorced, it was the man who would gain custody of the children, not the woman. And we tend to think of that as very reverse now. So the woman question actually is something that we think of it as being, we have this long history where the notion of what it meant to be a woman was very stable. And then we had all this disruption, but actually there's been disruption all along. But as we approach the late 19th century and turn into the 20th century, the question about what a woman's role is becomes very deep and serious because women are entering places, especially women who are in the middle and upper classes are entering workplaces they haven't worked before. Working class women always worked. But it's about that perception of what is the proper role for a middle and upper class woman. Relatedly, were a lot of questions about woman as an object of beauty. And we see this, if we think about woman as objet d'art and the ways in which these pieces both portray that, but also question that. So when we see a woman that looks herself like a piece of art, but in a way that makes us uncomfortable as we do in these images, it can ask us to think about woman as performer, woman as disrupting that role, woman as challenging that role. And an interesting literary piece related to this is Mary Braddon's Lady Audley's Secret. And that's another great mind candy novel. So if you're looking for interesting and engaging reading, get through those first 50 pages and people will find this one is another really fascinating novel that really speaks to, if you think about how in these pieces we're positioning, that women's bodies are being positioned and examined as objects of art, but also the ways in which they're disrupting that sense of a woman as an object of art. The title character, the heroine or anti-heroine of Lady Audley's Secret is a woman who's incredibly beautiful and incredibly enchanting, but who also has a dark underside to her and disrupts that image of a woman as just simply an object of beauty. And you can see how that related very intimately to those questions about what a woman's role was, because she wasn't just arm candy. She wasn't just eye candy. There were all these complexities to her, and you can see the ways in which these pieces do that as well.
Thank you. Your scholarship has also focused on the domestic violence laws enacted during this era. Would you share the most significant legislative changes and explain why they were important for women's rights and places in society?
Absolutely. It was such a fascinating study. That was my first book. And what I really explored and what I discovered in that exploration, I looked at legal documents, I looked at literature, I looked at visual art. And an interesting side note on visual art, the dust cover for the dust jacket for my first book has the work of a Scottish artist on the front. And it depicts a woman clearly in a state of distress and fear, leaning over to protect her child's cradle and clearly in fear for herself. And the editors at the press said, gee, isn't that kind of a disturbing image? And I said, well, domestic violence is quite disturbing. And it was this 19th century Scottish painter who was depicting a sort of disruption of the domestic space. But what was so challenging about that image and what I found in both the legal debates and the literature is that people could imagine domestic violence as something that happened in the working class. But it was very difficult for them to imagine domestic violence as something that happened in genteel society, whether that was in the middle class or the upper class. And what the fiction and even what my cover demonstrates, what the visual art did at that time was say, don't be so sure that it's only happening where in what the class that people would often call the roughs. It wasn't just happening amongst the roughs. There was disruption in middle class and upper class households too. And in fact, a famous piece was written by a woman named Carolyn Norton, who said, we must call upon our governments to step in. When if our husbands are our proper protectors and they do not protect us, we must call upon our governments to step in. But it really took literature and art more broadly, including visual art, to create an image that people could understand of women who might be subject to violence. In both of those novels I mentioned, Ellen Wood's East Lynne and Lady Audley's Secret by Mary Braddon, are novels that suggest that maybe the domestic space of even the most polite families is not as comfortable as it seems. And so the laws changed in part as a response to what became imagined possible by literature and art. So I argue in the book that literature and art actually had a massive influence on the law.
That's fabulous. Social justice in art. That's amazing. So how did these laws impact the protections for women that are in place today?
It's such a great question. And what I came to discover is how foundational they were. So American law and British law is based in large part on British common law. So the things that were common practices in Britain became a part of British law, and American law was very influenced by British common legal practice, in part because we were a colony at first, and so our laws were based on British laws, and then our own contemporary law grew up around that. And what those initial laws did is they said, we need to ensure that there's a way for women to respond if they are subject to certain kinds of violences. So initially in Britain, divorce was only possible by an act of parliament. And that act of parliament, the proceedings for that act of parliament were incredibly expensive. And only a man could sue a woman for divorce, not the reverse. And it was based on the notion that if a woman was unfaithful, then a man's heir might not be legitimate. So what happened in the 19th century is new ways of understanding what were legitimate reasons to leave a marriage emerged. And a lot of those were around violence or adultery, even by a man, which was new, or a desertion. So a woman could appeal on those grounds. And it really took enormous effort on the part of not just the legislatures in both the US and Britain, but then also the courts to begin to imagine what might be appropriate. And in fact, in the US, fairly recently in our history, our legislators and our courts began to recognize what's called a reasonable woman standard. So we've had a reasonable man standard for many, many years. What would a reasonable man think in this position? And there were cases that began to emerge in the 70s where people said, you know, actually, we think that a woman and a man might even think a little differently in these situations. Might a woman feel threatened here when a man didn't? And so the courts actually introduced the concept of a reasonable woman standard. And that was a new way of understanding things like sexual harassment in the workplace or gendered violence, either in the home or out in public. And that changed what happened in the courts. But that change really began with a change in thinking in the 19th century that said, there might be some things we have to imaginatively understand differently. And that might be that in places where we don't have direct access, in somebody's private home or in somebody's heart or mind, that if in those places where we don't have direct access, can we actually imagine taking up that other person's place and sitting in that other person's place? And does that then change the way we think? And I think that's often what art, visual art and literature do for us, is they give us that opportunity to take up a different, imagine things from a different space. And that's really what changes how we work as a culture. We often think it's intellectual debate, but what research shows us is it's often being able to imagine the space in which that somebody else inhabits that makes the biggest change.
That's so beautifully said. And that sense of building empathy, I think, among people can only improve our society moving forward. Thank you, Dr. Trump, so much for joining me today. It's just been a pleasure talking with you. Is there anything additional you would like to add before we say goodbye today?
Well, I think, you know, given what you've just said, Melanie, I should say that sometimes people ask, oh, what's the point in the modern world of literature or art history when we have so many serious problems to solve with engineering or science or accounting, those practical measures? And I think we've seen in this moment of intense polarization how powerful it can be for us to learn from each other through the arts and the humanities and the role that they can play in not just helping us talk with one another, but actually healing our society so that we can work together in ways that are effective and help all of us thrive.
Thank you so much.
Thank you for the opportunity to be here with you.
Thank you. We so appreciate it. And I just am so happy that we're able to share your expertise with our audience as well. Thank you. I am pleased to welcome Dr. Catherine Aiken. Dr. Catherine Aiken is a 20th century U.S. historian with an emphasis in social and cultural history, women, and labor. She is an emeritus professor of history at University of Idaho. She holds a PhD in history from Washington State University. She served as an associate dean at both Lewis Clark State College and the University of Idaho, chair of the U of I Department of History, Dean of the U of I's largest college, the College of Letters, Arts, and Social Sciences, and Provost and Executive Vice President at the U of I. Dr. Aiken has also won numerous teaching awards, which include the ASUI Outstanding Faculty Award, the University of Idaho Award for Teaching Excellence, and has received the Alumni Award for Excellence 5 times. In addition, she was a leader in establishing the current University of Idaho General Education Core Curriculum that includes a Core Discovery Program. As an historian, Dr. Aiken is the author of 3 books and is an active public speaker who has addressed audiences throughout Idaho and the Pacific Northwest. Well, thank you, Catherine, so much for joining us today. I have a series of questions that I would like to ask. And I'll start with the first one, and that is, the American Impressionism masterworks in the exhibition at the Boise Art Museum were created during the time period from 1865 to 1920. This era was marked by increased women's involvement in the public sphere. Why historically have women been so involved in reform movements, and how is this linked to ideas of voting rights?
So thank you. I think part of it is that as early as the late 1700s, women and men began to develop separate spheres, and the women's sphere tended to be in the home and with children. And of course, it's perfectly fine if you never have to be exposed to anything outside the home. As we know recently, that is often not the case. And so as women began to be concerned about their homes and children and those kinds of issues, then a number of topics that were related to reform come to the fore. And in addition, this is a period of a very strident and active evangelical Christian movement that demanded that people actually take action in order to demonstrate their Christian faith. And lots of women were involved in that as well. And so the combination of those things allowed women to expand their sphere outside of the home in what Jane Addams, the most famous reformer of all time, referred to as municipal housekeeping, which I think is a nice term. It's outside of the house, but it doesn't take women out of their sphere. So some of the things that women were interested in, like pure food and drugs, because they were afraid that might impact their children. Or a big campaign was to eliminate the public drinking cup that people used in all kinds of situations, which is hard to imagine now. And they just thought maybe a drinking fountain would be better than everyone sharing the same cup all of the time. Or in a lot of industrial areas, they were worried about smoke and how their children would breathe that smoke. And so they had an environmental concern. Education was especially important, obviously, for women and their children, so they wanted to make reforms. So kindergartens are an example of reform. Playgrounds for children in cities, because they thought children didn't get to go outside. Prostitution became a big issue in this reform period, because people thought young girls were often snatched from the street and forced into prostitution, and it was a big issue. But the biggest one, I think, was prohibition. Women became very concerned about the use of alcohol because they thought it took men away from the home because they were out in saloons, that maybe they spent money that should have gone to feed their children or improve their homes, and because they had kind of a moral issue about it. So all of these things became important to women, and it soon became clear to them that the vote was a way that they could get other people in American society to listen to their concerns. And so I think that's the tie between reform and the vote.
Very interesting. So this year we celebrate the 100th anniversary of women's suffrage. What were the most significant moments in the suffrage movement?
I think that's a question that is pretty complicated, and probably any historian you ask that might have some different answers. But as far as I'm concerned, there are a few. One is the World Anti-Slavery Conference in 1840. In 1840. Women, white women, became very concerned about abolition and about the issue of slavery in the North. And in fact, they were leaders in the campaign against slavery. So several of them attended this conference in London. And when they got there, women weren't seated. And so two women, especially Lucretia Mott, who was a prominent Quaker abolitionist, and Elizabeth Cady Stanton, who's one of the big stars of women's suffrage, they had to sit up in this gallery in a special part. And then there was a little curtain placed in front of them so that the men who were involved in the conference didn't have to see them. And that was pretty humiliating, but it also provided them an opportunity to talk to one another about how maybe this wasn't very fair. And maybe, besides thinking about the rights of African American people, that they ought to be thinking about their own rights. And so they did. And that really led them 8 years later to what I would call the second important piece, the Seneca Falls Women's Rights Conference, which we're all familiar with, where Lucretia Mott was really the leader, but Elizabeth Cady Stanton wrote a big part of the Declaration of Rights that was the main document from this conference. It's interesting that the question of voting was the most contentious at the conference. People were afraid that that just went a step too far, but they decided at the last minute to include it. So I think that's the second one. Third one, I would say, is the 15th Amendment to the United States Constitution. After the Civil War, and as I said, women were really involved with abolition, the 15th Amendment gave voting rights to people regardless of race, color, or their previous condition of servitude was the word, but it didn't include their sex. And so people like Abigail Scott Duniway and Susan B. Anthony were really upset about that. And it caused a big fight in the women's suffrage movement between those who thought this was the men, this was black men's turn, the Negro hour, as they called it, and we should rejoice in their having the vote and work for our vote later. And those who thought, no, this isn't fair, we need to vote at the same time. And in fact, both Elizabeth Cady Stanton and Susan B. Anthony often said very racist things about African-American uneducated voters as opposed to educated white women like them. And it became a a theme, I think, in the women's suffrage movement about race and ethnicity. So that was when I think. Of course, when you live in Idaho, I guess one of the other important developments is several Western states, including Idaho, granted women suffrage in the late 1800s. And I think that was important because often states like Idaho, where we received the suffrage in 1896, were looked to as an example of how voting worked and that it hadn't been disruptive and that kind of thing. I would say that Alice Paul's formation of the National Women's Party is a really important step. There certainly was the National American Woman Suffrage Association, which was a mainline suffrage organization. But Alice Paul and some others thought that they weren't working fast enough. And so she organized the National Women's Party, which held this big parade on the day that Woodrow Wilson arrived in Washington, D.C. for his inauguration. And it's a really famous story. He got off the train. He said, "Where is everyone?" And the answer was, "They're at the suffrage parade." And a few years later, the National Women's Party began to picket the White House. They're really the first example of someone picketing the White House, which is a familiar sight to us now. And eventually the Wilson administration arrested some of them. They were incarcerated in prison and forcibly fed in a really form of torture. So I think the National Women's Party is an important one. And then, of course, the 19th Amendment itself, which we're celebrating a 100-year celebration. So those are the things I would think are important points in the women's suffrage. And I think the thing to remember about it is how long we're talking about. I mean, the first example was in 1840, and the vote isn't till 1920. So that is a very long campaign for rights.
So why did some women and many men oppose women's suffrage, and what did this reveal about gender expectations?
Well, I think there are a number of reasons. One of them certainly is religious, where some of the biblical teachings seem to indicate that women should play a certain role, and a lot of people talked about that. But this is a time to look at the three paintings that we're thinking about. I think where all those women in those paintings, they aren't in a domestic situation in those paintings. And as I looked at them all, they look independent, especially the woman at the dressing table. I mean, she's pretty pleased with herself and with the whole kind of situation. And she is not reliant upon some male partner in that situation. So I think partly there was a concern that if women voted, it would expose them, and here in a political year, that it would expose them to the nastiness of the American political system, and that would be a bad thing. I think that's one of the reasons. A lot of people thought that women simply didn't have the intellectual tools necessary to make important political decisions, and so there was considerable conversation, I think, about that. One of the things that goes along with the vote is serving on juries, and there was considerable discussion that if women served on a jury, they would hear about these very unsavory cases and crimes, and they would not be able to do that, but also they would have to sit in the jury box next to men they didn't know, and what if the jury was sequestered? They would have to spend the night away from home, maybe even in a hotel without a family male member to sort of supervise, and that would be frightening. I think people worried that it would detract from men's masculinity and their role as the breadwinner and leaders if women had the vote, and that was really, really frightening, that it would actually threaten, I think, men's masculinity. But more important, there's a lot of conversation that it would threaten the femininity of women and that they would not be up on that pedestal and that same feminine sort of person. And when I looked at the three paintings that we're talking about, those women are incredibly feminine in a number of ways, and that's what people expected women to be, and they didn't want them to be anything else, I think. And lastly, there's lots of conversation that if women got involved in politics, they might not keep up with their responsibilities as wives and mothers, and that there's lots of cartoons at the time of men left home with screaming babies that nobody was there to take care of because women were off engaged in politics. So I think all of those things are reasons why people oppose suffrage, both men and women. Women thought that their role might be threatened, and the clear sphere that they had established that we talked about before might be in jeopardy. So that's what I think.
Those changes would be scary in society during that time, yes. I would imagine.
Yes.
So you've already touched on this a little bit, but can you talk about how did race and class change expectations of and for women? Do you see any representation of this in the artwork in the exhibition at the Boise Art Museum?
I certainly do. All these Smithsonian pieces are of middle and upper class women. I mean, if you look at the dressing table and the items that are displayed on it, or if you look at the home where the woman has the, first of all, she has a Greek statue, not many working class or Black people had a Greek statue to hold up, but there's that kind of Chinese screen and the, just the nature of how that looks. And even the woman in the mantilla, who is a person of color, but there's a difference when it's a foreign person of color, because that has sort of an exotic element to it rather than a person of color in the United States who would look very, very different. And I think that's true of the entire suffrage movement. Middle and upper middle class women tended to be the most visible advocates for women's suffrage, although Black women were involved, especially through church, because that was an important organization to them. And working women are incredibly important, obviously. Many of them were immigrant women, and it was a real challenge. Some suffrage workers knew they weren't doing as good a job as they ought to be doing in representing working class women, but working class women took it on themselves to think about the suffrage. And in their case, it wasn't just voting for political reasons. They thought voting might improve their lives through issues of wages and hours, that kind of thing. And so one of the most important and famous slogans for working class women is, "Give us bread, but give us roses." This notion that it's not enough to just survive, that people need some beauty and other elements in their lives, which seems appropriate when we're talking about art. And the fact that they recognize that that's what they needed. And in the California suffrage campaign, which was successful in 1911, that's an important slogan. And for Rose Schneiderman, who's one of the most famous working women advocates of suffrage, that's an important slogan. And I just always revel in that notion that women, even when a lot of them didn't make enough money to barely feed themselves or their families, recognize that they needed more. Seems really important when we're talking about art and its role for everyone. So I think those class issues, they were problematic from our standpoint for women's suffrage, but there were examples of people of color and working women who were interested in suffrage as well.
Why and how did women fight for their right to vote?
Well, sometimes I think maybe this is pretty obvious, but maybe not. In a democracy, I would say exercising the franchise is one of the most important elements. And in American society, especially, people have been talking about the vote really from the inception of the United States. And much of the traditional rhetoric that we think of as American, like no taxation without representation and the right to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, all of those kind of things that we associate with give me liberty or give me death. All of those things that we associate with kind of being an American are tied to the franchise. And women soon recognized that if they didn't have the vote, they really wouldn't be a part of the body politic, and they wouldn't be citizens. And being a citizen of the United States is one of the key elements of being a part of American democracy. And in an election year like this, where we're talking about it, we recognize just how important that is. And women recognized how important that was. And that's why they were willing to fight so hard to get the vote, I think. And I think it's a lesson about how we have a responsibility now to exercise that franchise that they and others worked so hard to achieve.
That's a wonderful message. So I did not have this question on my list, Catherine, but can you tell me, did the 19th Amendment actually give all women the right to vote?
Well, no, it did not give all women the right to vote. It excluded, well, certainly, we aren't even exactly sure who was allowed to vote as a result of the 19th Amendment, to tell you the truth. But certainly some Native peoples and certain tribes were not allowed to vote as a result of this. And even though the amendment ostensibly would have granted the franchise to African-American women, Black women in the South, like Black men in the South, were victims of what we would now call voter suppression, all kinds of laws and challenges that made it difficult for them to vote. It was also actually difficult sometimes for a lot of people in a rural area to get to vote. And certainly Hispanic women in a number of situations were limited in their right to vote. And so that's why this issue of who can vote and who not can't vote continues to be at the forefront, even 100 years after this amendment, as people recognize that it's a key element of citizenship and people demand to have it, and some people would like to limit it.
Yes, it's a very timely conversation with the election that's happening today.
Yes.
Let's see, I had one more question that came to mind. Oh, you mentioned the length of time that this movement spanned. So it must have actually sort of been passed down almost from generation to generation, this movement,
yes.
This effort.
It's amazing to me that, you know, few of the women who started this campaign were even alive at the time that the 19th Amendment was finally passed. And it really is, if you figure, for easy figuring, that a generation is 20 years, well, think how many generations of women had to be involved in this campaign between the 1840s and then 1920. And so it was a constant effort, especially women had fewer resources monetarily at their disposal than men because of the nature of the economy. And they had these responsibilities for home and family that we've been talking about. And they didn't have as many forums for action. And so the fact that they were able to organize themselves across a country where travel and communication was not as easy as it is now, and to have coordinated efforts to gain the suffrage for all those many years is pretty amazing. And many of them suffered physically terrible torture in jail, but other kinds of difficulties as well. They were sometimes shunned or had issues with their family when their husband objected to their position. Many people sacrificed a lot for women's suffrage over a long period of time.
It's really remarkable.
It is. It's amazing. Which I think, to be more positive, the same is true of Black voters. The vote is so important that people are willing in this country to do whatever it takes to exercise it. And the fact that they don't get tired and just give up, but they keep pushing for it, is one of the great things about American democracy, I think.
Yes, very inspirational.
Yes.
Well, this was wonderful. Thank you so much for sharing your expertise with us. I really appreciate the connections that you've made between the women's suffrage movement and the artwork that we have on display at the Boise Art Museum. And I know that our viewers will appreciate that as well. So Thank you so much, Catherine.
And thank you very much for having me. I enjoyed it.
I'm thrilled to be joined by Dr. Brian Hodges and Lindsay Bowl. Dr. Brian Hodges is Associate Professor of Cello and String Pedagogy and Coordinator of Chamber Music at Boise State University. He earned his DMA in cello performance from University of North Carolina in Greensboro. He leads Classical Revolution Boise, an alternative to the concert hall. Classically trained local musicians perform in a relaxed atmosphere in order to bring classical music to the people of Boise. Founded in 2012, Classical Revolution Boise has established itself in the community as an exciting, accessible, and fun way to experience classical music. After completing her master's degree from Northwestern University, Lindsay Bowl won a position with the New World Symphony under the direction of Michael Tilson Thomas. It was there that she discovered her passion for playing in an orchestra and a strange enjoyment of practicing orchestral excerpts for several hours every day. Other highlights of Lindsay's career include performing with the Hawaii Symphony Orchestra, American Ballet Theater, Phantom of the Opera on Broadway, and playing Hava Nagila for Itzhak Perlman. Lindsay currently serves as the Associate Principal Viola of the Boise Philharmonic. Thank you so much again, Dr. Hodges and Lindsay Bowl, for being here with us. I have some questions to ask you related to the exhibition at the Boise Art Museum of Women in American Impressionism and some interesting ways that that relates to music and your expertise and background. So my first question is, was there an impressionist movement in music as there was in art? And of course, for visual art, that spanned from 1865 to 1920. What was happening with music during the Impressionist art movement? And what was happening in American music compared to European music?
Yes, there was an Impressionist movement in music. It happened a little bit later than the Impressionist movement in art. What was going on when all that was happening in the art world was essentially German Romanticism was all the rage. So music was getting bigger and more epic and just kind of crammed with ideas and emotions, and it was really getting pushed to sort of the breaking point. You have symphonies of Gustav Mahler, which, you know, one symphony was about an hour and a half long, and he talks about putting a whole world in a particular symphony. So just again, just infusing it with so many ideas and emotions. I think it's pretty telling that most professional orchestras, when they program a Mahler symphony, there's not much that they pair with it on the same program. Because what do you pair with that type of a piece? It's just so much. And, you know, a listener can only absorb so much, you know. He's got a piece called The Symphony of a Thousand, which combined with the choir and orchestra, that the idea was that there are 1,000 people on stage. So, you know, how much bigger can you actually get, you know? So while all the Impressionist movement and art was happening, that was happening in music. And then the Impressionist movement really began naturally in Paris around the turn of the century and stretched to about 1930s. And we really credit two composers, Claude Debussy and Maurice Ravel, with being Impressionist composers. Although neither of them liked that term, neither of them liked being associated with that. Debussy himself really bristled at that title. He preferred to be more aligned with the Symbolist poets rather than Impressionist painters. But I mean, you listen to his music and it sounds very, very Impressionistic. It's like the oral equivalent of a Monet painting. It really is. I like to say that, you know, you'd be like Debussy painted in watercolors versus the oils and acrylics of the Romantic, you know, period. So, but in a way, his music is sort of a reaction against that German Romanticism, which the French saw as very overwrought and overdone and sort of overcooked, very tasteless. So Debussy's music tends to be a lot smaller, a little bit more intimate. I would say less goal-oriented. Sometimes it's kind of harmonically vague. The melodies, the ideas kind of drift in and out, and they just kind of leave and they don't really go anywhere. He himself even said that he wanted to see a kind of music that had no no real concrete ideas and thought, which he never really quite get to. He doesn't get to that point, but he almost does. And we have an example here of one of his most famous pieces. It's called Prelude to the Afternoon of Faun. And again, I think you can really hear the impressionistic qualities in this piece. In terms of what was going on in American music, I mean, a lot of the Americans, like in the 19th century, in the concert halls, it was all imported European music. And you had a lot of the famous European composers were coming over and conducting American orchestras, like Mahler, Dvorak, Tchaikovsky. So American audiences were getting this steady diet of, you know, Beethoven, Tchaikovsky, all imported. And there really was no American identity in music until the 20th century. And then it's like typical American culture. It's sort of this patchwork of different influences and cultures. There's a lot of folk idioms that were included, jazz, and then of course some impressionism, because a lot of American composers, Aaron Copland was one of them, went over to Europe and studied, and then they brought that back. So there's not necessarily an impressionism movement per se in American music, but there's vestiges of that in their pieces for sure.
And was that actually something that was done kind of alongside the Impressionist movement, or was there a pushback with what was happening with the Impressionist movement in visual art, or was there really a correlation at all?
Well, again, in America, it happened quite a bit later than in the art movement. And I think it was just, they were reacting to what was happening in Europe at the turn of the century, bringing that back to America and kind of putting it in the melting pot, per se.
Thank you. So the exhibition at the Boise Art Museum focuses on women in American Impressionism as artists and as subjects. Can you tell us about female composers from this period in time and any particular challenges they may have faced due to their gender?
Yeah, so the 19th century is really a time where we're starting to see a lot more women starting to emerge as composers. In previous time periods, it was kind of speckled here and there with, you know, maybe one woman that we kind of have heard of in earlier time periods, where we're really starting to see a lot of women making a name for themselves in composition. Definitely they faced a lot of difficulty in that profession, both from their families and from society. It was really seen as not a profession for women. I mean, really anything outside the house, right? And I'm guessing that was probably similar for women in the visual arts as well. But anything that women wanted to do outside of the house was very discouraged by their husbands, by their parents, and by society. So there was a stigma too about women on stage and what that meant, and so that was one of the reasons it was really discouraged for women. So I have a few examples too that I'd like to talk about women who married and then had to stop kind of composing. So they really didn't have a lot of options other than to get married. Just it was sort of an economic decision that women had to make. So Amy Beach is a composer who married at the age of 18 and married a man who was, I think, about 25 years older than she was. And he was kind of interesting in that definitely he discouraged her, but they came up with an agreement that she could perform one charity recital per year. And he did not want her studying composition, although he still encouraged her to work, which is interesting. So she was allowed to compose and work, but not study with anyone. So she did a lot of what she wrote about is studying scores, really complicated fugues and symphonies, and actually memorizing them and writing them out by hand just to understand how they worked. So she was very largely self-taught. Clara Schumann was another one who, when she married her husband Robert, who's also a composer, very much discouraged it, made it very clear to her when they were married. He actually gave her as a wedding present a cookbook, which I don't think would go over very well. But anyway, so he gave her a cookbook and wrote a song cycle that was basically like a manifesto to the duties of marriage. So it was very clear to her. And she has a quote that she said, I once believed that I possessed a creative talent, but I have given up this idea. A woman must not desire to compose. There has never yet been one able to do it. Should I expect to be the one? So it's just, it's really sad to me to read that and think about all the music that we lost that these women were never able to write because they were discouraged from doing so. And another one that I'll mention was Alma Mahler, who's Brian mentioned, Gustav Mahler, her husband, who the symphonies that Symphony for a Thousand, the big works, he actually made it a condition of their marriage that she stopped composing. And she said, I have been firmly taken by the arm and led away from myself. So yeah, a lot of discouraging things to hear about what women faced at that time. And some women did write under pseudonyms. Rebecca Clark sometimes wrote under the name Anthony Trent, just so that they could have their works performed more.
So how did Schumann and Mahler then, how were their works able to come to light if their husbands weren't allowing them to do this?
That's a great question. I think that, you know, they were discouraged for sure. Obviously they were still writing some, and I don't know how much of that, Brian, you might know the answer to this, but how much was written before they were married and how much, like, it seems to me like a lot of that output stopped once they were actually married, and it was done a lot in their younger years. A lot of these women are referred to as child prodigies who were writing at very young ages. So my understanding is that it kind of ended, or the outputs really got a lot smaller once they were married.
And I think in Clara Schumann's case, he died fairly, I mean, much before her. he tried to commit suicide and he ended up in an asylum, and he was a bit of a mess. But so I think there might've been some composing after. She lived quite a bit longer after he passed away. But I do think you're right, Lindsay. I think most of it happened before she was married. And I think, you know, she was an interesting case where her father actually did encourage her, and she was a brilliant pianist. She was one of the top performing pianists. She toured around Europe. I mean, she was kind of a superstar from a very, very early age. Lindsay mentioned, you know, child prodigy from her teens. She was out there concertizing. And her father actually, when Robert, the two of them started their courtship and they announced their intention to marry, her father said, no way, because I think he was afraid that Robert's career would supersede hers and that she'd be domesticated in that sense. And so they defied him and they got married anyway, but of course that pretty much happened. And but so yeah, I think Lindsay's right. A lot of that happened before she got married. And I think with Alma Mahler's case, they got divorced at one point. They were not a very, as you could tell by what, you know, Lindsay said, they weren't a very functional couple. There was quite a bit of turmoil in their marriage. So, you know, how that, you know, affected her composition is hard to say. But
Rebecca Clark was a really interesting woman to me because she actually didn't get married until her late 50s. She was kicked out of the house pretty young, in her late teens, maybe early 20s, by her father. And she was able to make a career for herself as a performer. She performed with some all-female ensembles, which is really interesting. So she did support herself and then got married in her late 50s. So I think for her, she was able to do what she wanted to do.
And let's make that point that the composition stopped when she married, even in her late 50s, and that was it. So yeah, even then.
those societal roles, they weren't allowed to step outside of those. I wonder if there's any evidence that their musical compositions or musical abilities actually helped their husband's compositional work, even though they weren't allowed to do it professionally. I wonder if it influenced their work at home.
Yeah, it's a good thought, you wonder.
Hard to know since they were completely overshadowed by
that. Yeah, oh yeah, for sure.
I have one more question for you, and that is, this time period saw significant innovations in art materials and styles. Can you tell us about some female composers who stand out to you as innovators?
Yeah, we mentioned a couple. I mean, Rebecca Clark, it's incredible. She was in one of the first all-female string quartets, and they toured around, and so that was a big deal. So there was two sisters, Nadia Boulanger and Lily Boulanger. Lily actually is considered an impressionistic composer, so she's one of the few that's really categorized as such. But she was one of the first females to win the Prix de Rome Composition Prize. That's a huge, huge deal. And there was a lot of sort of derision because how dare a woman, you know, enter this competition, and you know, how dare she actually win it? You know, Rebecca Clark was also a composition winner. There was these big composition contests set up in England, and she won. And you know, there was a lot of sort of opposition towards that, and you know, how dare she? And well, she writes like a man, so of course she won. You know, that kind of weird stereotypes. But Nadia Boulanger is actually one of the biggest composition teachers of the 20th century. I mean, the list of students that studied with her is incredible. Like people like Philip Glass, Aaron Copland, Piazzolla. She had a huge hand in shaping the role of music and the sounds of the 20th century. It's absolutely incredible who studied, and surprising because you don't think of Philip Glass and Piazzolla as having a very similar style at all. But she apparently was someone who had a gift for finding someone's individual sound and then getting them to find that voice within themselves. And so that's why you have such individual, you know, sounds and styles from these composers. It's really incredible.
And if you don't mind, Brian, if I jump in here a little bit about Nadia and Lily, it's really interesting because Nadia she actually said that the true musician was Lily. So, you know, all the stuff Brian was talking about with Nadia teaching these composers that we all know and have such varied styles, that for her to say that her sister was the true musician. And Lily actually died very young. I think she was 21, 22. She was very sick as a child, and she just, so that's another one that we missed out on a lot of what she would have done. But we do have an example to play of Lily Boulanger, and it's Spring Morning. So that's another clip that we'd like to play.
So was Lily's work considered impressionistic as well, or only her sister?
Yeah, Lily was the one that was, I think, really considered the impressionist. I think Nadia, you can correct me if I'm wrong, Lindsay, but she was more sort of the avant-garde. She was really on the vanguard of where things were moving into this sort of esoteric, you know, in terms of new ideas of harmony and, I don't think Nadia is considered to be an impressionist, but Lily certainly was. Yeah. But yeah, unfortunately she died at, you know, I think it was Crohn's disease. It's sad to think about what she could have, you know, written after that.
Can you tell us some of the technical aspects of the work that would make it be deemed impressionism?
Kind of what Brian was talking about earlier with Debussy, some of those ideas where it's a little bit more like the melody's a little bit more wandering, doesn't have quite the same like goal-oriented feel, I think is kind of what Brian, the word you used. And I think that's the same way you would describe this. To me, when I hear it, if I didn't know, you could almost say like, oh, that's Debussy, you might guess that it's his music. So yeah, I would say it's definitely that sort of meandering very, very watercolor sort of feeling. To me, I think it's funny that a lot of these composers that did not like that label of Impressionism, to me, like, when I hear composers of this time period, like, I can picture Impressionist paintings. Mm-hmm. And I don't think there's many other musical time periods where I feel that, where I can get that real visual sense of the art. And I definitely do that with the Impressionist composers.
Absolutely. Yeah. Yeah, Rebecca Clark, she also has some Impressionist, because a lot of times her music is sort of confused with Debussy, or they say, oh, she has elements of Debussy in her music. And for her, I feel like it's more, she uses the same techniques that Debussy does in terms of harmony. Very, very open, almost medieval sort of harmonies, open fifths, parallel chords that way, that was sort of a no-no before that turn of the century time period. So she borrows sort of a lot of those same techniques, and so there's sections of her music that sound very, very reminiscent of Debussy, and so has that sort of impressionistic color as well. We should probably talk about Ethel Smith, or Smythe, I guess. I'm not sure what's the correct Smith with a Y, but she was obviously a composer, but a huge political advocate who fought for women's suffrage. And she wrote a piece called March of the Women, which ended up being the anthem of the suffragettes, which we actually have a clip for that right now.
Can you tell us more about that piece and where it fits into the musical canon or the historical canon of music?
So if you listen to it, I mean, it very much is kind of what you would expect an anthem at that time period to be. I wouldn't call that particular piece, it doesn't speak to me as like, oh, that's an impressionist piece of music. It very much is an anthem. And so when you hear that clip, you'll see, you know, it's got words and the women singing. So I don't know if that answers your question.
Absolutely. Yeah.
It's more of a rallying cry, I think. And her other music, I mean, Lindsay, you can correct me if I'm wrong, it has more of the late romantic feel, sort of more Brahms, Tchaikovsky lushness to it. I think she was a little bit before the specific impressionistic time, but she was right there at the forefront of everything that was happening. She was jailed for a while, and supposedly she led a chorus. They were in the courtyard. She was leading them and conducting them, singing, and she was. Yeah, very passionate, very, very, very involved. It's great.
Yeah, and she actually took 2 years off from composition and from music to sort of be a part of that movement, of that suffragette movement.
That's fascinating. You know, one of the artists in the exhibition, Mary Cassatt, was also definitely involved in the women's suffragette movement. So. Very interesting, all of the parallels that you can draw between visual art and music during so many different times, but this time period, I think, in particular.
Yeah, absolutely.
Are there others that you wanted to share with us today?
We have one more musical example. We talked a lot about this composer already, or I did, about Amy Beach. And so the example that we have to share of hers is she wrote some piano miniatures, which are really described as impressionist works. And so this particular one is called, I think a lot of them were written around like bird song, or to sort of emulate bird song. And so this one is called Hermit Thrush at Eve. And it's really lovely, really beautiful piano piece. Thank you.
So when I think of Impressionism, there is an aspect of capturing a specific moment in time, almost a fleeting moment in time, and this idea of bright light and reflective surfaces and things like that. Do you feel like this music kind of gives you the same sorts of feelings as that the visual art is trying to evoke for people?
Yeah, I think it definitely goes along with what I was saying before of why I can picture those paintings that we all know when I hear the music. I think that's a great way to describe it, is that it captures that moment of sunlight, of the sunset or the sunrise, those fleeting moments. I think it really does such a great job of capturing those moments and making you feel that, you know, when you see those paintings, it's like, you know, that moment of the day when the sun looks just like that. And I think it's the same for a lot of these works.
Yeah. You think of the piece we played earlier, the Prelude to the Afternoon of the Faun. And I think Debussy's trying to capture just that impression of being in the woods and the sunlight kind of coming through. And I think it's like what you said, trying to capture just a fleeting moment and then it's gone and then you're onto something else. And yeah, that's again, like what Lindsay was saying, I see the paintings as I hear the music. It's the connection is very clear in my mind. Maybe it wasn't on Debussy's, but you know, unfortunately, but yeah, it's very clear to my ears.
Thank you both so much for sharing your expertise with us. This is just such a fabulous way to be able to see the paintings in another dimension with the music with it. So thank you again so much for sharing your expertise with our audiences.
Of course, thank you.
It's been a pleasure, thank you. I'd like to thank our sponsors and grantors. We are fortunate to have support from local and national funders to make this new program possible. Generous support for this project has been provided by Art Bridges, a national foundation focused on American art. This program is also funded by the Idaho Humanities Council, a nonprofit organization that serves as a state-based partner of the National Endowment for the Humanities. Bev and George Harrod have provided generous support of this exhibition, making this program possible. Thank you to Dr. Marlene Trump, Dr. Catherine Aiken, Dr. Brian Hodges, and Lindsay Bull for sharing your expertise with us and giving us an interdisciplinary lens through which to appreciate the artworks in BAM's exhibition. The exhibition, Women in American Impressionism, will be on display at the Boise Art Museum through Sunday, November 8th. I hope you will be able to visit. Thank you for your support and participation in BAM's Parlor Nights program.